Alright, welcome to my Nier Replicant Hard Difficulty No Damage Guide, in which I'm going to take you through all of the main game boss fights, all the way up to ending E, and explain how you can beat them without taking a single hit. And I would actually very much recommend trying this yourself, because I think a lot of you would agree that, even on hard mode, this game can lack quite a bit of challenge, mainly because you can take so much damage before you die. But if you cannot take any damage at all, it becomes a different story and makes it more akin to Automata's very hard mode, which this game doesn't have. But I believe it was Voltaire who famously said that if very hard mode did not exist, it would be necessary to invent it. Or something along those lines at least. So for that reason I also chose to not use the Dark Wall spell, because that makes you completely invulnerable in certain fights. Now we are going to play smart of course, but we also don't want to trivialize these fights. So some of the strategies I use are actually purposely suboptimal, because my goal is mainly to make the fights more interesting rather than merely finding any sort of way to get through them unscathed. But I will explain that along the way. And I will at least mention certain cheese tactics or more optimal strats, in case you are curious. Now you may wonder if not taking any damage is even possible in every boss fight. Because don't you take automatic damage in some places? And yes, that is correct. In the fight against Goose, and the memory data version of Hook at the end of the game, there seems to be scripted damage. Goose's poison aura seems to be unavoidable. Not only can you not cure it, but even if you could, you would still take the initial damage anyway. And not even Darkwall can protect you from it. And it does make sense for this to be scripted, as it leads into a cutscene where the aura literally brings you to your knees. Same goes for the first phase against Data Hook, where due to the absence of Wise, and therefore the lack of ranged attacks, you cannot prevent the magic attack that knocks you down. And neither Darkwall, dodging, jumping, nor blocking will prevent that damage either. Moreover, that leads into you losing most of the control you have over Kaine, until she faints, and after the following cutscene, you regain your health anyway. So again, this makes sense as a scripted event. And during the second phase, it looks like you take damage when you lose your balance, because of the arena-wide AoE, and not even Darkwall prevents you from getting hit by that and losing your balance. However, during that phase, including that attack, although it looks like you take some sort of chip damage, that is actually due to the visual distortion effects where the edge of your life bar flashes. This even happens when clearly nothing could potentially hit you, and also happens if Darkwall is active, which makes you completely immune to the damage from the orbs in the arena. So for the specific scripted events, unless someone can figure out the equivalent of cancel slashing so fast that you can destroy the demon head before it hits you, for those who get that reference, this seems to be intentional damage by design, that we are therefore simply forced to accept. But all avoidable damage we are going to avoid. So allow me to show you how to do it. We immediately start off our list of boss fights by fighting two bosses at the same time, at least initially. So although I'm going for a parry strategy, which is a real shame by the way that didn't carry over into the sequel, but because both of them are active at the start, I first mainly rely on magic and allow them to come to me and parry as a response rather than actively going in to bait an attack in order to parry it. But after a short while, we'll be fighting Hansel and Gretel in turns, and you will notice that I don't keep Darkblast going, which doesn't look like a smart decision, but the reason I do this is because the particle effects and flashing lights kind of make it hard to actually see when their weapons are about to connect with you. So I mainly rely on melee attacks and combine them with Darkblast during a riposte animation, or when the boss is knocked down on the ground. When it comes to parrying, it's better to press the block button a bit early, because if you mistime it, you will at least block the attack, and then you can try to parry the next attack instead. And although it looks like I didn't actually do it initially, but when you do a riposte, hold the square button rather than tapping it, because then you will do extra damage. Now they also have charge attacks, so when they start screaming or shaking I should say, use Darkblast while preemptively running around them, and tapping the button to do single shots will make you do more damage, but you can also choose to hold it for the benefit of the slow motion effect, giving you more time to react. Keep that in mind, I will mention the slowing down effect of magic attacks a lot throughout this playthrough. Now on hard mode, the bosses are quite tanky, so you need to combine specifically single shots and melee attacks to break the gauge before the timer runs out. Unfortunately, in this case the lock-on screwed me over and targeted the wrong boss. Yeah, that's unfortunately not the only time that the lock-on can mess you up. Well, at least the gauge doesn't replenish, so if you can't break it the first time, you will get it the second time.
A talking book and moving statues? Really?
It is all too real, lad. Keep your sword high. Now, put it out of its misery.
Okay, second phase. First of all, now you get the Darklands ability, and the annoying part of playing with custom controls is that gaining new abilities screws with your control setting. And speaking of Darklands, although it's in principle more powerful than Dark Blast, given how much faster you can attack with Dark Blast, in the end it simply provides a higher damage output, and on top of that pretty much no need for MP management. Although you could actually charge it up while baiting a parry, given that I chose not to be firing Dark Blast anyway, in order to see the attack coming. In fact, that's exactly what I'll be doing in the next boss fight. Anyway, this phase is just a one-on-one fight with Hansel, and Gretel will remain inside her shield until you kill him. So it's merely a matter of getting close, bait an attack, parry and riposte. And remember to hold the square button for maximum damage. One slightly annoying thing though is that when he's close to Gretel, you can actually bounce off against her shield when attacking. So it might be smart to lure him away from her. However, as you saw, he can now shoot a barrage of fireballs at you. And so can Gretel once we get to the third phase. So two things to keep in mind for that attack. One is that it has only mild tracking, so it can quite easily be sidestrafed. And secondly, that the fireballs can in fact be destroyed with Dark Blast, just like red projectiles. In fact, you can even absorb them with Dark Gluttony, but that's obviously only applicable in the second encounter with Gretel, as we don't have that sealed verse yet. Okay, final phase. And although Gretel fights the same way as Hansel, this phase starts with a horde of small shades while Gretel uses a fireball barrage. So remember what I said about that attack and use Dark Blast to quickly dispose of the smaller shades. Because in a way, they are more dangerous than the bosses. At least in a no damage playthrough, because whenever you are close to them, they can bump into you and do a single HP of damage. Yes, that's not a joke. Even when later on in the playthrough you have about 100,000 HP, you can literally take a single hit point of damage by having a smaller enemy bump into you. That's why frequently throughout this video you will see me bringing up the status screen to check if I really did not take any damage. Because your life bar can look like it's completely full, even though you're not actually at full HP. Now, every time you take damage your life bar will flash, so when looking back at the footage it's easy to see that you never got hit, but when playing it's easy to miss that. So that's why checking the status screen is so important. Other than that, the fight remains the same, so keep parrying until Gretel goes down as well. But of course, we will see her again later on in the playthrough.
This one excels at close combat. Keep your distance.
The second fight is arguably one of the best in the game, which is actually not surprising since I regard Shade Kainé after beating the Shadow Lord as the best fight. And this one is similar, although she has a much more limited moveset. In fact, she doesn't even attack at all in the beginning. She will only guard. However, she can still hit you when you knock up her in the air. However, once she says son of a bitch, she will start counterattacking. So don't just mindlessly attack her and then suddenly get hit because you didn't expect her to start attacking already. Now just like with the previous boss, I think Dark Blast makes it hard to see your attacks coming. However, as I mentioned, we have an alternative that makes it actually easier to parry her. namely by charging Darklands, because charging any magic will slow down time. And Darklands has an added benefit, because if you knock down Kaine after a parry, you obviously get a free hit anyway. But if you knock her up in the air after a parry, she can actually follow up with an aerial downward attack. But if you release Darklands right after reposting her, you will shoot her right out of the air before she can hit you. So that's pretty neat. And be glad that you have that benefit in this version of the fight, because when finding her Shade version after the Shadow Lord, we don't have any magic to work with at all. We don't have Wise anymore, so therefore it will be a pure melee fight. Now, one very important thing to keep in mind is that you always need to be sidestrafing in this fight, unless she is running towards you to do a melee attack. Because at any other point, she can do a charge attack, which as far as I know cannot be parried, but definitely cannot be blocked. So if there's distance between her and you, you need to be sidestrafing. And that's even more important when she gets into her third phase, where she gains magic attacks. Because although her magic ground wave attack can in fact be blocked, this game has a very peculiar guarding mechanic. Because even though you can block projectiles and melee attacks, your guard can be broken as well. And it's very hard to tell when exactly that is going to happen. Because it seems to be that this game has something like an invisible counter that keeps track of how many times you've blocked an attack. And that probably combined with an RNG factor as well. So you can successfully block several attacks initially, and then a few combos later, you suddenly get guard broken. And this feels even more random when it comes to projectiles, even though it probably isn't random at all. It's more a matter of not being able to keep track of it. So if she does her homing magic projectiles, which she actually didn't do in this fight, you need to move as far away from her as you can, sidestrafe to dodge as many projectiles as you can, and then guard to block the remaining few, so that if you get guard broken, it's not within Kaine's attack range. But keep this quote-unquote hidden guard counter in mind, because it's going to be important for later fights that have bullet hell style projectile attacks. Because you might think that you are invincible while blocking, even without Darkwall, but that's actually not really the case. Okay, so directly after fighting Kaine, we have our first encounter with Hook. And this will be the most straightforward version. He essentially only has three attacks, although one of them will go at different speeds throughout the fight, and that is his stomp attack that has an AoE around it. Which unfortunately is a type of attack that gets completely overused in this game. But given that we have to attack his hands anyway, immediately move over to his left one, so right from your perspective, and thereby you will completely avoid the projectile barrage, which is his second attack. As long as you stay close to his hands, that will never hit you, and because we don't have Dark Gluttony yet, we cannot use it against him yet anyway. Now, when attacking his hands, obviously combine Dark Blast with your melee attacks for maximum damage, and if you have trouble timing your dodges to avoid the AoEs, you can use Rapid Fire instead to slow down time, making it easier to dodge those waves. Especially handy, when he starts slamming his hands down in quicker succession during the second phase. But before that, he will crawl backwards and spit out multiple smaller shades that will shoot projectiles after a short while, when they are on the ground. But if you keep firing at his mouth, you can destroy most of them before they even hit the ground. In fact, you can even use the homing projectiles from letting go of rapid fire to automatically target any shade that slips through. But now he will start doing the stomp attacks in rapid succession. So now it's helpful to use rapid fire to slow down time. And you can even switch to tapping right after dodging and then holding again when the next stomp attack is coming, so in order to increase your damage output. Now, as you notice, I use the actual evade button and not the jump button to dodge the AoEs, even though that might be your natural tendency to jump over those waves. But in my opinion, evading is much more beneficial than jumping, not only because you have iframes when evading, a lot of them in fact, and whenever you are using melee attacks, you can immediately attack after dodging. And yes, you can attack after jumping as well, of course, but aerial attacks have the danger of landing right on top of the incoming wave. So in general, I at least prefer to use evading rather than jumping in most cases. In fact, the very next fight will demonstrate this benefit and how many iframes the rolling animation actually has.
Yeah.
I told you to stay out of the way!
The symbols are disappearing.
Huh? Alert. Alert. Intruder detected. Unauthorized trespassers will be eliminated. Sensor initiation. Trespassers identified.
This bodes ill. It appears that only machines remain in this infernal place.
What's going on?
Alright, next up is the Geppetto Defense System. Pretty lengthy fight, but heavily based on patterns, so there's not that much RNG involved. And as I just said, let's demonstrate how many iframes you have when rolling in this game. Because it's pretty understandable that you would automatically think to jump over the lasers, but it's actually more effective to roll through them, which completely eliminates the danger of jumping on top of the lasers while they are moving along with you. First, get to the top of the arena, as the laser starts at the bottom. Then they will stop for a short while in the center, and then they will move towards the top. So when they are about to reach you, run down and roll right through them. The rolling animation is not like in a Souls game where you only have iframes at the start, but instead you are invincible during the entire roll. But regardless, try to avoid where the two lasers intersect. So move along the edge, so you only have to roll through one laser at a time, and then move back to the top, because they will cease firing before they reach you. Then move towards the bottom, because now lasers will come from all fingers simultaneously, starting at the top. And here it may be easier to jump instead. But let me again demonstrate the power of evading, because you would think that the hitbox of all those lasers together would be too large to roll through, but as you can see, that's not the case. Okay, for the third laser pattern, move towards the center, stop firing when the lasers activate, and then you can move in between them, and you can roll just to be safe if you think the lasers are too close to you, but the point is that they leave a small gap for you to squeeze in between them. Then you can keep firing until you see the hand you're firing at point all the way to the side of the arena, and that means that the lasers will move back towards you. So that's your cue to run towards the bottom of the arena, so that you can then circle around the edge back towards the top. Now the hands will try to crush you, and two things to watch out for here. One is that you don't run away from them in a straight line, or else they might come down when you are stuck against the edge of the arena. And two is to avoid the fingers if you can, because that's obviously part of the hitbox as well. So don't move out from underneath the hand in the direction of the fingers.
Keep an eye on the shadows!
That was the entire sequence of the first phase, and it will simply repeat until you've drained his entire life bar, and then the second phase will start. Okay, second phase is not against Geppetto himself, but against a barrage of robots. Rely on magic over melee attacks here, because of the electricity in front of them that will automatically damage you. Two things to keep in mind here. One is to make sure that you don't get stuck between enemies, of course including the new enemies that will spawn around the edge, and to pay close attention to robots that you've already killed, given that they explode after a while. So in that sense, they are still a danger even after you have killed them. Make good use of the lock-on, because these robots have little health, so you can quickly dispose of them one after the other by relying on lock-on. You can also go for rapid fire to slow down time. Moreover, when the turrets appear, which is the third wave, releasing rapid fire to activate the homing projectiles will almost instantly dispatch of the majority of the turrets, allowing you to focus on the one or two remaining. And remember that the red bullets can be destroyed by magic. Alright, final phase. Now the head will launch a barrage of homing missiles at you, so run around in a circle until they stop, and remember that rolling is faster than running, so that can help you to cover more distance. When the head lowers down towards the edge of the arena, that indicates that the missiles have stopped. Then pick up a bomb at the side, because the laser will start firing down the middle, and then move towards the head along the edge before throwing, otherwise there's a chance that you will miss its mouth. Now you need to repeat this process until it's dead. However, each time you do damage, the next missile barrage will have more missiles, and they will also move faster and faster. So make the circle that you run around the arena larger and larger. In fact, at the end I went for the bomb on the left instead, because I had to make more than a single circle around the entire edge by that time. And two things to keep in mind here. First of all, don't get fooled by thinking that the missiles have stopped, only to get hit by one last lingering behind a bit. So look at the head, don't stop running until it moves down. And the second thing is to start running immediately when the head moves up, because the missile barrage will then immediately start. As long as you keep those two things in mind, it's just a matter of time before you will eventually take him down. Okay then, time for the second encounter with Hook. And here, well, even though I was successful in killing him without taking any damage, this fight turned into a bit of a clusterfuck, where my strategies didn't really work as intended. So on one hand, that's pretty bad when making a guide, but on the other hand, this will at least get the principle across and show you how to deal with it when things go south. Although this has nothing to do with Hook himself, but with the shades you encounter in between the phases. Now when it comes to the first phase, it's the same thing as before, hand slams followed by shockwaves. So just like in the previous encounter, you can use the slowdown effect of rapid fire, or charging any other magic attack for that matter, to give yourself a larger window of opportunity to dodge through the waves. I still don't bother using his projectile barrage against him, because it simply does hardly any damage. So you could, but there is just no benefit to it. Instead, the second spell I have equipped is Dark Hand, but that's not meant to use against Hook. Instead, it's to deal with the shades you encounter along the way, towards the second phase of the fight. However, as I said, that did not turn out the way I actually intended it.
I'll tear out your goddamn eyes and piss in the sockets!
Good sweet lord! I have never heard such a thing. Kyanae struggles. You must hurry!
I'll take care of the big one. You worry about the rest.
So here is what I was trying to do. The shades with shield are magic resistant, but ironically, certain spells can knock them down. And Dark Hand, when charged, can knock them off the bridge altogether. Even an entire group of them. And yes, I tested this out and this does work, but I guess it's just kind of RNG heavy and I got bad RNG. I just couldn't get them to fall off. And on top of that, there's a third shade that shoots projectiles. So I had to improvise a bit, and eventually I was like, yeah, fuck it, I'll just jump over them. But of course, these are not the only shades along the way. Well, the next group shoots projectiles as well, which you can counteract with projectiles of your own. However, given that I wasn't intending on moving back here, I didn't bother killing them. And that's a problem when you are forced to go back there, as you will see. So I charge up Dark Hand again to knock the entire or at least most of the next group of shielded enemies off the bridge. And again, this is possible, I did test this out. But yeah, it does not work consistently at least. So I had no choice but to make a run for it. Which does work at least, because due to the difference in elevation near those houses, and the fact that those enemies cannot jump, when they follow you, they cannot move back towards the bridge. But given that all the previous enemies were still alive, things did get a little bit tense. And a little bit clusterfucky. So after making it past all those enemies, I made another mistake, because I was locked onto the final enemy remaining, and although I was smart enough to not use rapid fire, you know, because when you release it, you activate the homing projectiles, but I almost encountered a similar problem because of the lock-on. Fortunately, I stopped firing soon enough, so it was only a single projectile that bounced off. But still, it's the principle. I said before that the lock-on can sometimes screw you over in this game. And that still applied when finally getting to the second phase of Hook himself. Because now he's releasing those ball-shaped shades that shoot projectiles after a while. And it's probably hard to tell from the footage, but I was really struggling with aiming where I wanted to aim because of the lock-on. And therefore, my advice is to simply use free aim and make use of the homing projectiles by releasing rapid fire to hit all of the shades at once. That will be much more reliable.
Oh,
Now, when the gauge appears, unless the Shades are already on the ground firing at you, I would advise to keep firing at his tail anyway, but be ready to dodge, because at any time when he's not releasing Shades, he can slam his tail down. And in this case, he managed to sneak in that attack just right before I could destroy the gauge, but fortunately I was able to react in time.
Running already.
Kaine, I'll drive him to you. Get up there and wait for him.
All right, watch yourself.
All right, so now we encounter a whole bunch of projectile shooting Shades that all need to be killed in order to progress towards the next phase. And they only shoot red projectiles, so you can destroy those with your own. But make sure that you block in case one happens to slip through. Moreover, a kind of weird thing because of the sideways perspective, but there are slight corners in this section, and because you cannot fully aim in every direction, again because of the perspective, firing straight forward will cause you to miss the Shade right in front of you, or better said, that isn't right in front of you because of the angle. So that's another reason to hold your sword up, and something that can help you out here is by using the homing projectiles, which not only helps near corners, but it can even allow you to hit a Shade that's on another floor, because they can move around corners. And that can allow you to stay out of their line of fire.
This ends now, asshole.
Okay, now we have another group of magic-resistant Shades to deal with, but I'm simply going to avoid them. And remember that they cannot jump, so at the very left, I break the box and lure the Shades towards me so that they fall down. Now you might wonder, why are you so extremely careful around these enemies? Why not simply fight them with melee attacks if they are magic-resistant? Well, on a regular playthrough that wouldn't be an issue, but remember what I said in the Hansel and Gretel fight. These small Shades can very easily do extremely mild chip damage to you, just by quickly bumping into you, which normally is hardly even noticeable, but on a no damage playthrough, all damage that can be avoided has to be avoided. So I'm simply not taking any chances around those little fuckers. Okay, two more phases to go. Before the cutscene, he can only do the hand slam AoEs again. But this time they go in quicker succession, so use rapid fire to slow down time, and only go for a single strong attack in between dodging through those waves, because if you get too greedy, you might not be able to dodge in time. So it's much better to be patient.
Doing my best.
Thank you. Kaine, it's me, Grandma. Oh, how you've grown.
Kaine, what's wrong?
Oh, it gladdens my heart to finally see you again.
Grandma?
Come, Kaine. Come to your grandma's side. You've been lonely for so, so long. So much pain, so much despair. Why go on living anymore? Kaine?
Is that it?
Are
you finished yet?
Don't speak to your grandma like...
You're going to stop talking now. And then I'm going to slowly walk over to you, cram my hand inside your goddamn bitch-ass chest, and pull out your fucking heart!
Okay, I hate to talk over Kaine's emotional dialogue here, but now move back onto the bridge to avoid Hook's charge attack, and then focus on his right hand. As long as you're not directly next to it, the shockwave from his other hand won't be able to reach you there. And then, for some reason, he takes a pretty long break before spitting out a group of ball shades again. So you could actually go in for melee attacks until he does that, which I do later, but at this point I just took a patient approach. And when the ball shades are on the ground, focus on them because of the inevitable charge attack after that, meaning that he will automatically place himself into your line of fire anyway. And then he will do the hand slam AoEs again. This process will simply continue until you deplete his entire life bar. I initially approached his face differently by standing behind his right hand to avoid the charge attack. However, standing here on the bridge is actually much more effective. And there will be no danger of getting stuck.
That attack's bad news.
This doesn't look suspicious at all. I suppose that was to be expected.
Hey, look!
Next up is Shariar, or however you pronounce it. This is a very lengthy fight that's mainly about patience and blocking projectiles. Now, in principle, you could just hold the block button while constantly using the rapid fire version of Dark Blast, but that's actually not the best approach. Not only will it take multiple shots to destroy its block, but all the blocks that you don't need to hit will fire projectiles back at you if you hit them. So instead, I'm going to use his projectiles against him using Dark Gluttony, because unlike against Hook, It's very effective against this boss, because it destroys the red cubes in one attack, and will only result in a few extra projectiles from one or two non-mandatory cubes that get in the way. On top of that, with Dark Gluttony, you will automatically aim at the red cubes, so that's pretty handy as well. Now, whenever you need to deal with projectiles while guarding, side-strafe to avoid as many of them as you can. Because remember that even though it may feel like you're invincible while blocking, and you've probably successfully blocked whole barrages of projectiles before, but then, suddenly out of nowhere, you will get guard broken and take damage. So, in a no-damage playthrough, my advice is to not take unnecessary risks, and simply avoid as many projectiles as you can, and only block the ones that you cannot actually avoid. Now, there are words that increase your guard resistance, so it may in fact be that certain words can make you almost invincible, but then the actual challenge becomes to stay awake while just standing there blocking attacks without being in any sort of danger. So in that sense, I think it's a good thing that your guard can at least be broken. So when it comes to words, I simply focused on attack power and experience points boost. Okay, second phase. Now he turns into his mega cubazoid form or whatever. And surprise, surprise, he can now do slam attacks that cause AoE waves.
How original.
Although his very first attack does nothing for some reason. However, after the first AoE attack, blocks will spawn on both sides and then move across the screen from top to bottom. And then back to the top again. There is no real strategy to it, this is purely about quick reflexes. Although what you could do is charge a magic attack to slow down time if you have trouble avoiding these blocks.
This is a powerful foe.
There you are, you bastard! Kaine! I'm gonna kill the shit out of you! Now hold still and die already!
Alright, so after Kaine joins the battle, the slam attacks with AoE waves continue, and you need to destroy the hands. And interesting little detail, the hand consists of 4 blocks, and you might not manage to destroy all of them at once, but if you first destroy the bottom ones, the AoE waves no longer get triggered after he slams his hand down. So even if the arm remains intact, it's basically harmless with the bottom cubes destroyed. Okay, the final phase, and now things get a bit more tricky, because now we won't be able to use Dark Gluttony to auto-aim and destroy the red cubes in a single attack. However, the homing projectiles from releasing rapid fire when using Dark Blast is a decent alternative. Moreover, the slowing down effect when holding rapid fire helps when dodging the lasers. And for the lasers, there's no real strategy, this is simply about reflexes and spacing. And of course, you need to keep in mind that you have tons of iframes when rolling, Which means that rolling when a laser gets near you can save your ass if you're not sure whether it's not going to hit you or not. Also, an alternative to Dark Blast would be to use Dark Lance, because that ability has a crosshair that can help you aim. But in my opinion, the homing projectiles of Dark Blast are the way to go, as it allows you to focus on avoiding the lasers rather than to focus on hitting the right cubes. Now, to be clear, although it's true that the other cubes release projectiles when destroyed, but the dark ones cannot be absorbed by Dark Gluttony, unless it's in combination with the light red projectiles. That's the only way you can absorb them, if they are mixed together, and not if they are by themselves, as is the case in this phase of the fight. So use Dark Blast and focus on avoiding the lasers, because this is a pretty lengthy section, but with a bit of patience, you can slowly make the boss smaller and smaller, until the last block remains, which will end the fight. Well, technically there are four of them at the end, but whatever.
This is it. We should find the cure somewhere nearby.
Bah, I do not like anything about this place.
Okay, Grimoire Rubrum is next, and I guess it's kind of a practice run for Grimoire Noir, because it doesn't really do that much. It's like a nerfed version of Grimoire Noir. It does have two phases, but during the first phase, he only has a single attack, and that is to spawn a circle of pages around him. But all you need to do is to keep at a distance when you see the wind effect indicating the spawning of the pages, and then destroy them with Dark Blast. Then move in for melee attacks, because Dark Blast cannot damage this boss directly. So, if you wonder why I keep firing at him anyway, that is a good question. The general pattern here is that the boss will spawn pages, then it will move to a new location, and then the next time it moves, it will spawn pages again. That's really all you have to keep in mind. There's very little going on in this fight. Oh, and when the gauge appears at the end of the phase, Dark Blast will do damage, so do use it in combination with melee attacks to destroy the gauge before the timer runs out.
can't.
Okay, second phase. Now it will start charging through the room, and the thing to really pay close attention to in this phase is that the moment it starts spinning, you need to dodge out of the way. Because right after it starts spinning, it will charge towards you. Well, actually, it can troll you by rolling into another direction, so don't let that throw you off. And Grimoire Noir will do the same thing later on when we fight against him. And fortunately, now Darkbless will do damage to it when it's in its sphere mode. Speaking of which, this is again a situation where you can hold down the magic button to slow down time, so that you have a little larger window to react to its charge attack if you want. But that's all there is to this fight. Again, it's like a practice run for when we eventually face off against Noir.
This is my fight! I can't ask you to die for me!
My, aren't we the bold one? And yet I fear that would be a foolish course of action at this juncture.
Besides, we'd never let you do that.
Would you all please just shut the hell up?
What?
I'm just saying, if you bastards want to have a goddamn civilized discussion on the merits of bravery and sacrifice, we can do it later!
Is this your way of encouraging us?
Have we truly sunk to motivational speeches from a woman in her undergarments?
I guess so.
Okay, now for a very lengthy battle, technically a 5-year long battle. It's the giant shade known as Jack of Hearts, even though I have absolutely no idea why he's called that, because I don't believe we get any sort of background on this enemy, but whatever. This is another multiple phase battle, but especially during the first two phases, it's not the boss himself that poses the biggest threat, ironically. It's the smaller shades in this area. Well, at least the boss has very unique attacks, namely he does stomp attacks that have an AoE wave around them.
How original.
My advice is to stand underneath the boss and face the opposite direction. That way you can see those shades coming and you can focus on them instead, if necessary. Actually, it's possible to completely cheese this phase by running all the way behind the boss, near the gate leading to the Southern Plains, because from there you can still hit the boss, but he cannot even see you, nor will the smaller shades follow you all the way over there. We're not going to do that because that's kind of boring, but I thought I should at least mention it. Okay, so now you're supposed to get upon the wall and shoot the beast in his mouth, but that's actually not a very effective approach. Not only are you in the line of fire then, when he does his projectile breath, but shades will approach you from behind again, and those are still more dangerous than the boss himself. So we want to have them in front of us, not behind us. So instead, I will position myself next to his right hand. Now in order to do that, you first need to get past his left hand, And don't get greedy when attacking that hand, because he creates a large shockwave across the wall when he slams it down. So here I choose to double jump to get over it. Although it is actually possible to iframe it with a roll, believe it or not. But in this case, that's simply way more risky than jumping. Now, the only messed up thing about this strategy is the camera, because you can't really see that well what's happening. But the point is that from here you can see the shades approaching you and focus on them instead when they get close to you, because they can actually walk right through the boss's projectile barrage. Speaking of which, you can actually get clipped by the edge of the projectiles at the very side of that wave. So whenever he is spitting those orbs, make sure that you are blocking. Especially because I said that it's still possible for a shade to make it all the way towards you, and of course the camera is an even bigger threat than they are. Other than that, there's another downside of standing here, and that is that you need to finish this phase on the boss's left hand. You can damage him anywhere, but the gates that you need to break can only be damaged on his left hand, which he might be holding up in the air when it appears. Or he might be spitting orbs, or you may need to focus on incoming shades instead. So this phase will require a bit of patience, as he will likely get the opportunity to heal himself. So it's not a perfect strategy, but it's still better than standing on the other side, where shades can approach you from behind. By the way, this phase can also be completely cheesed by running past this wall and get to the left side where you can shoot the boss, but the shades won't follow you. Although you would then still need to move back to his left hand when the gauge appears. You can still destroy it from a distance with magic, of course, though. But yeah, the movements of the boss himself are extremely limited. If only he could just attack with his other hand or turn his head around, but maybe that's where his name comes from, that he basically can't do jack, or that he doesn't have the heart to go outside of his very limited programming.
Look where it's headed!
Like hell it is!
Alright, now the third phase. Just like Hook, he can now spit out a bunch of those ball shades that will shoot projectiles at you. However, it won't take that much to break his right leg, which is all you have to do in this phase. And because it takes so long before those balls will actually shoot balls at you, I simply focus on his right leg and simply move back when the balls start balling. So as long as you don't get too greedy, you should be fine. Otherwise you will get balls in your face.
This isn't working.
So what do we do?
You guys having a good time? Huh?
Kaine!
Okay, the fourth phase. The boss will now completely ignore you and make his way towards the library, and you will automatically lose if he gets there. So this is about draining his life bar before that happens. Well, at least now he gains a completely new attack that we've never seen before in this game, namely doing stomp attacks with AoE waves around them.
How original.
Yeah, so it's best to position yourself behind his feet, because it's not merely the wave that counts as a hitbox. The movement of his feet can also damage you, which you can circumvent by attacking him from behind. He is quite tanky though, so it takes quite a few hits. In fact, it may even feel like it takes 5 years to kill him.
Come now, that's not even a real word.
Looks like you've learned how to swing that thing.
I'm glad you noticed.
You're almost there. Keep pushing.
You really know how to put up a fight, Kaine.
When his life bar is completely drained, he won't stop moving, but you do have to get in front of him so that you can finish him off by shooting his head before he can actually reach the library itself. Because if you don't, you will still automatically lose, even though he doesn't have any health left.
You stubborn son of a bitch!
Shades in the library. Yona!
Well, even though Jack's body completely disappears after this phase, the fight isn't actually over, as its head somehow survives, even though it's a bit of a missed opportunity that they didn't actually have it visually remaining behind after its body vanishes. But anyway, we still have two more phases left to go, because once you get inside the library, you will first need to fend off a group of regular Shades. Well, after all of that, and especially because of how incredibly awkward the save point is placed, which is before Emil entered the town, and I did want to keep this entire fight a single segment, I therefore played it very safe against these Shades and simply circled around them and focused on evading them while relying on Dark Blast to slowly whittle down their health bars. Now, having said that, after this fight, before taking on Noir, there is a fight against a group of Shades where you are forced to use only melee attacks, and even though it's not actually part of that boss fight, I did include it as bonus footage, because I did want to show you how to deal with Shades using melee attacks without taking any damage. So that will be a little bit of bonus footage.
Emil, just don't die on me.
I won't, Kaine. Let's take care of these shithogs.
I like it.
Shades in here.
Emil!
Is there no way to kill this infernal thing?
Okay, final phase. Well, not counting doing the exact same thing again 5 years later. But despite the fact that we have to seal him away because he is seemingly invincible, he doesn't exactly do that much in this phase. However, when going for no damage, you still have to be careful, because after he jumps up and smacks down onto the ground, which doesn't have an AoE around it, surprisingly.
Daring today, aren't we?
He can seemingly out of nowhere flail his tentacles around. So after he has done his little jump, it's best to keep your distance. However, I had the bad luck that the final gauge was between his giant head and the wall, so I couldn't actually hit it. Which is actually a good thing for this guide, because you might not even be aware of this, because you would have likely already beaten him at this point. But he has a third attack, where he starts swirling across the ground, and that will turn his entire body into a giant moving hitbox. So you will need to circle around with him until he stops. And to emphasize, until he has fully stopped. He actually slows down a bit before he stops spinning, so don't allow that to throw you off and approach him too soon. And remember that if you need to move faster, rolling covers more distance than running. I haven't seen an actual speedrun of this game yet, But I would assume that speedrunners are just constantly rolling throughout the entire game simply because it's faster than running.
Derek, knock it down the basement!
Okay, so as I said, here are some bonus footage from the fight right before Grimoire Noir. And given that he drained Wise from his powers, we are forced to fight these shades without any sort of magic. And even though they are quite tanky, there's a quick method to take them down. When you hold the triangle button instead of tapping it, you do a different version of the strong attack combo. And for unarmored shades, the final step will result in a knockdown. And whenever you knock down a shade, you can do an execution move with the circle button that will kill them instantly. Well, there are some exceptions to that rule, but these ones won't survive that at least. You cannot get hit during that execution move, but you do have to be ready to immediately dodge out of the way of a potential incoming attack of one of the other shades when you come out of that animation. Now, it will take more than a single strong attack combo while holding the triangle button to knock down armor shades, but those can still be knocked down as well and then insta-killed when they are on the ground. So that's the most effective way to deal with armored shades. Unfortunately, the armored shades you fight right before Goose in the Shadow Lord's castle have roll attacks where they end up on the ground as well, and that does not allow you to do an execution move. So don't get fooled by that. Also, whenever Kaine or Emil are fighting with you, even though it seems like their attacks don't actually do anything, they can actually knock down shades as well. So that will also allow you to then execute them. Okay, so now it's time to take on Grimoire Noir and slowly regain our magical abilities. So initially we still only have melee attacks. He summons pages like the other Grimoire, however these ones shoot projectiles at you, and the pages will be in different positions throughout the phases of the fight. Remember what I said about blocking projectiles before? Do not feel invincible while blocking. Try to avoid as many as possible, because you can seemingly out of nowhere get guard broken and take damage. And just like against the shades, I use the strong attack combo where you hold the triangle button, because it does more damage than when you tap the button. Every time you break one of the gauges after doing enough damage, you regain one of the sealed verses. And the annoying thing is that the new one will override the previous one, and I always want to have Dark Blast available, so I put it on L2 rather than on L1 like I normally have. By the way, as you might have noticed, I use custom controls to begin with block on R2 and evade on L1, which also kind of bites me in the ass near the end of the game, so I actually don't recommend doing that. But the reason I want to mainly use Dark Blast is because it helps to get rid of the pages that Noir summons. Other verses can do that too, but this is just a simple method that doesn't require any charging up or MP management. Keep in mind though that just like Grimmar Rubrum, you cannot do damage to the boss himself with Dark Blast, unless it's when the gauge appears. And then you definitely want to use it in combination with your melee attacks to break it before the timer runs out. Now, when you get Dark Lance, you can do extra damage to the boss himself, since that attack will do damage to him. However, keep in mind that every time you break a gauge, the L1 button gets overridden with the next sealed verse. The last of which will be Dark Execution, which will immediately trigger the final phase of the fight. And here is the fucked up part, and a typical Yokotaro trolling move, because the boss will become a near instant hitbox when the final phase starts. So if you're doing melee attacks, it's very likely that you will instantly take damage. So we will have to work around that. The first before that one is Dark Wall. So when the boss's life bar is completely drained and you get the remaining verses one after another, what you need to do is to not break the final gauge to get the last verse with melee attacks, because we need to be at a distance already when the final phase of the fight starts to prevent being inside of that instant hitbox. So that final bit of damage has to come from a ranged magic attack. Okay, so as I said, when we get Dark Wall, we know that there's only one gauge remaining, so I stop attacking right before it breaks. Now, if I had been a little bit faster, I might have been able to finish it off with Dark Blast before the boss could heal himself, but yeah, that didn't happen, so we have another large chunk of his life bar to deplete. But the important thing now is to make sure that you finish him off from a distance. So I use Dark Lance for that, because although you can break the gauge with Dark Blast, you cannot damage him in order to make the gauge appear with Dark Blast. So it's best to be a bit patient here, and you will see why it's so important to be at a distance when the gauge breaks. So now the final phase starts and Noir goes into his orb form and immediately starts spinning. And as I said, that's an instant hitbox. Now every time after that, you do have a little bit of time to react and dodge him when he starts spinning. But initially you are in the animation of acquiring the final verse, leaving you with practically no time to react. So that's why initially you need to be at a distance. So now the boss behaves similar to Grimmar Rubrum, so attack when he's not moving, and the instant he starts spinning, immediately evade. However, this time, more dangerous than the boss himself is the falling debris. Wherever you see dust fall down, that is where rubble will fall down after a few seconds. So don't merely have your eyes on the boss, look at whether you are underneath falling dust or not. One good thing though is that you can roll through the falling debris, so you can iframe it. However, don't take any unnecessary risk, of course. As much as possible, try to stand in the safe location where no dust is falling. Which I know can be tricky because you move when doing your attacks. So another thing to keep in mind is that it seems that debris doesn't fall down at the very edges of the room. Or at the very least not frequently. So the edges are the safest location. Well, as long as you don't get stuck between the wall and the boss, of course.
No!
You will understand in time.
Yonna!
Get up! No!
Give my sister back!
Kaine, no! You can't!
God damn it! We don't have a choice!
So what's the plan here?
First, you have to promise me something.
Hmm?
If my sister somehow manages to swallow me up, my original self becomes lost. I'm afraid I may try to hurt all of you. And if that happens...
No, wait!
Then I want you to kill me.
Okay, number 6, Emil's sister. Or better said, an amalgamation of Emil and his sister. And yes, visually and narratively this fight is pretty cool, but mechanically there simply isn't that much to it. The boss is quite passive, and given that you are forced to use magic anyway, you might as well be at a distance, which gives you enough time to react to her charge attacks, or when she shoots a barrage of purple bullets that can simply be sidestrafed. However, when she unleashes her bullet hell attack, the entire arena will get engulfed in projectiles. So don't just stand in place while blocking, because again, how the game actually decides when your guard gets broken is very mysterious and feels completely random at times. So sometimes you can in fact survive an entire onslaught of bullets, but sometimes a relatively short burst will suddenly break your guard and cause damage. So while blocking, try to position yourself in between the projectiles as much as possible, so that only a small number of projectiles actually need to be blocked. Now when this is happening, you cannot really hit her with rapid fire because of all the projectiles that will block yours. So I tried to hit her with the homing projectiles, because they move in an arch. However, that didn't really work that well either, which is why I also tried to move forward, so I could get closer to her. Because the lock-on target is her head, which is probably why the homing projectiles don't hit her from too far away, because of the angle. Once you knock her down, she will get into the second phase, where she climbs onto the walls. Perhaps the experiment she was subjected to also involved a radioactive spider or something, I don't know. And my initial idea here was to use Dark Gluttony to use her own projectiles against her. However, because she fires so infrequently, you will simply do way more damage by simply using Dark Blast. However, it's better to not be locked on, as I was here initially, because when she fires, the orbs move in an arch towards you, and it can be hard to follow that trajectory because of the camera angle when you are locked on. Regardless, you need to move towards her when she fires, But be aware that there is a single projectile that goes right down the middle. When she falls down, she will emit a whole bunch of red projectiles, which can be absorbed with Dark Gluttony, and actually does practically no damage, which kinda sucks. But it is better than nothing, as your Dark Blast projectiles probably won't be able to hit her at all. And keep in mind that when she gets back up, she can still do a charge attack just like in the first phase. However, then she will go back on the wall again, and the process will simply repeat until you have defeated her. And as you will notice, the second time she's on the wall, I do make sure that I'm not locked on, which makes avoiding the arcing projectiles much more reliable. There is one downside to not being able to use melee attacks in this fight, and that is that you won't have a high enough damage output to destroy the gauge before the timer runs out, unless you would use a magic buff. Or possibly you can do it if you stop using Dark Blast right before the life bar hits zero, and then do a fully charged Dark Lance. That might be able to do it as well, but that's not something I've experimented with. Regardless, even if she heals, the fight will continue just like before. Alright, the next fights are the Route C versions of the boss fights, which are the same as the B Route versions apart from the fight against Louise. However, because of the scaling, they are quite a bit more tanky. First up is the rematch against Gretel, which is a very similar fight as when Hansel was still alive, but there are some differences. The fight starts by Gretel repeatedly summoning a large amount of small shades while firing, fire at you. However, because of the broken roof, there is sunlight in the middle of the room, which automatically does damage to the shades. So the most effective way to deal with them is to lure them into the light. Which is why I don't merely side strafe, but run around the boss to get the shades to follow me, so I can get them to run through the sunlight again. Not only that, you do have to make sure that you don't get stuck between the enemies and a wall, because remember that on a no damage playthrough, you have to keep moving whenever there are small shades around you, because even though I have about 100,000 HP by now, if they bump up against you, you will take a single hit point of damage. And yes, that's not a joke. You can take 1 HP of damage, which is why it's important to check the status screen before finishing the fight, to make sure that you really didn't take any chip damage. When it comes to Gretel, this time you could actually absorb her fireballs with Dark Gluttony, but unfortunately that won't do much good to begin with. Especially because she takes massively reduced damage as long as the dialogue is playing, and you better get used to that. That is unfortunately a returning mechanic, and one that will become really annoying later on. So as long as the smaller shades keep coming, don't worry about doing damage to Gretel herself. And speaking of her fireballs, just like the red projectiles, they can be destroyed with Dark Blast. So you can actually shoot them while side strafing with rapid fire, and then release the button to hit the shades with your homing projectiles. But to be fair, the fireballs have poor tracking anyway, so as long as you're not near a wall already, they can easily be avoided by side strafing alone. When Gretel remains by herself, I took the opposite approach from before, and instead of parrying, I held rapid fire to slow down time, which makes it easy to dodge her attacks. Especially her overhead attack that goes nowhere near you as long as you're not directly in front of her. And for her sideways attacks, just like in a Souls game, roll through them, not along with them. Or you can circle around her to stay outside of the hitbox altogether. Just keep in mind that she can do the side swings in both directions, and she cannot hit you when you are directly behind her. Of course, a pair strategy is just as viable like it was in the first encounter.
felled the beast.
Okay, during the second phase, she gains a very dangerous attack. She can start spinning around the room, making her a constant and fast-moving hitbox. So here I use rapid fire for the slow motion effect, so I have some extra time to react whenever she gets close. However, that by itself is not enough, because you also need to make sure that you don't get near the walls. Because if you dodge her near a wall, then she can still hit you when she bounces off against the wall, exactly when you come out of your rolling animation. So make sure that you position yourself close to the center of the room. After that she goes back to melee attacks, and if you want to go for a parry strategy, I strongly advise to only parry sideways attacks, and not the overhead one, because the overhead attack has an AoE now. So that's another reason to not be directly in front of her. And which is another reason why I simply didn't go for a parry strategy at all. Because when you're not directly in front of her, that makes parrying her sideways attacks a bit trickier. And again, keep in mind that she has no attack that reaches directly behind her. So behind her it's safe. Well, until she starts spinning again, of course. Alright, now we have the first encounter with the Shade version of Kaine. However, this one is quite a bit different from the second encounter. First of all, because we don't have magic during the second encounter. And it's a good thing that we do have it during the first one, because she mainly crawls across the walls while shooting projectiles at you. So I shoot at her with Dark Blast until she starts firing back, and then I use Dark Gluttony to use her projectiles against her and knock her off the wall. So finally it's actually useful. Be careful when she's on the ground though, don't get greedy because she can immediately attack the moment she gets up again. And when she's on the ground, she can do a quick double dash, so that's another reason to stay away from her. She can also fire waves of projectiles while on the ground, so when she does, immediately get behind her, which allows for some free damage. However, those projectiles initially hang there in the air, and then suddenly start moving towards you. So when they start moving, run around in a circle while firing at Kaine with Dark Blast. And again, don't stay near her when she's knocked down, not even when the gauge appears, because again, the moment she gets up, she can instantly attack you. So unlike the second encounter, this is mainly a range fight. Of course, during the second encounter, you don't even have that option to begin with. Then it will be melee only. And it will then also arguably be the best fight in the entire game.
Stop Kaine from acting!
Oh dear.
What's happening?
This beast a shade as well.
That thing sucked up the villagers.
No! If we keep this up, we're gonna kill them all! We can't let that happen!
Well, speaking of the best fights in the game, the fight against Wendy is kind of the opposite. This is not exactly the most exciting boss fight, and strategy-wise, there is extremely little to it. This fight boils down to little more than just Dark Blast attacks. So it's best to go for single shots whenever the tentacles are not in the way, and when the eye does get blocked by the tentacles, go for homing projectiles, because those may arch around them, so they can at least get some extra damage in when you cannot fire at the eye directly. My second spell is Dark Gluttony, which I guess I should have used when the wave of projectiles went across the platform, because remember that you can still absorb the purple ones if the red ones are within the vicinity as well. So you cannot absorb the purple ones by themselves, but you can when they are mixed in together with the red ones. Doesn't make that big of a difference though, because the boss doesn't take that much damage from Dark Gluttony anyway. Now as you can see, I'm using a different melee weapon now, which I suppose I should have done before since this is Route C, and the Phoenix Spear outclasses the Beast Bane by quite a bit. Even when it comes to magic attacks, because when it's fully upgraded, which I believe it actually wasn't yet at this point, so in that sense it might actually have done less damage here, but at level 4, the Phoenix Spear will give a 10% magic bonus over the Beast Bane. And even though the Fool's Lament Greatsword outclasses the melee damage of the Phoenix Spear, when it comes to raw attack power, however, due to the speed of spear attacks over greatsword attacks, I personally definitely prefer the Phoenix Spear. So that will be the weapon I'm using for the rest of the playthrough. Well, until we play as Kaine in the E-ending section, of course. But this fight at least doesn't require any melee attacks. Although in the third phase you can sneak in a few here and there. But actually, even when the smaller shades are summoned, you do need to keep the minute chip damage that you can very easily take into account. So although on a playthrough where you can take damage, melee attacks would be very effective, in this case I just keep running around and relying on Dark Blast, so that I can also keep an eye on what the boss is doing. But in all fairness, there isn't that much strategy to it, and this was in fact my first attempt, and it was immediately successful. So if you're trying this for yourself, it will probably not give you that much difficulty to begin with. So yeah, not too exciting, but more a matter of just being patient.
Beating the smaller enemies has no effect on the leader. Focus your magic on the beast's center.
So for the second phase, you need to get behind the boss, and although there are no enemies along the way, when on the ladder, I actually almost got hit out of nowhere by a random beam. I'm actually not even sure if you can get hit by one of those beams, or what you could do to prevent it in the first place. In fact, it might even be designed to never actually hit you. Again, this was immediately a successful attempt, so I can't say that I experimented with this boss at all. So guide-wise, that's not that helpful, I think, but then again, I sincerely doubt that this fight would give anyone trying to go for no damage any trouble anyway. Same goes for the projectiles when you reach the boss. Of course, like always, only block as few projectiles as necessary. But yeah, again, there's just very little strategy involved in this fight.
It is escaping to the inner level. Oh.
I'm coming. Gotta catch my breath.
Careful, Emil. Won't help anyone if we lose you here.
Okay, the third phase is very similar to the first one. The boss just kinda does nothing mostly, while you are firing away at it. Until it summons Shades again. But after that, she does in fact gain a new attack, so yay! Okay, so after you defeat all the Shades, she fires a laser beam at you that slowly moves from the center of the platform to the back while moving from side to side. Although it doesn't actually reach the very back, and I would assume that moving near the front of the platform would help you to automatically avoid it, mostly. And you could even roll through the beam if necessary. So, yeah, it's not exactly a very dangerous attack. Well, at least after the laser beam, it gets a tiny bit more exciting as the boss now summons Shades and shoots projectiles at you. Meaning that you need to avoid both at once. So even though it's not exactly necessary, but having Dark Gluttony as your second spell can at least help you if you get stuck between Shades and a barrage of projectiles. Keep in mind though that you still can use Dark Blast with an empty MP bar, but Dark Gluttony requires quite a chunk of MP. So that means that if you don't have enough, you cannot activate it in the first place. So remember that for any spell other than Dark Blast, poor MP management can actually get you hit. Well, and then when you finally think the fight is over, you cannot actually do enough damage on hard mode without a magic buff to break the gauge in time. So maybe in this case, not using buffs was not really a very well thought out restriction. But that's okay, because that means we can enjoy this epic battle for a bit longer. And that's just great. Yeah. Alright, next boss is P-33, or BP, and his shade friend Khalil. And even though you see him use his machine gun hands in the intro cutscene, the designers figured that they didn't have enough bosses yet that have stomp attacks with AoEs around them. So that's basically what the first phase consists of.
How original.
Well, at least these are different types of AoEs, namely electric waves.
Daring today, aren't we?
And two specific variations. Whenever he stomps with his right foot, he will send electric waves towards you, which can be iframed by rolling, just like with previous AoE stomp attacks. And again, rolling is more beneficial than jumping in my opinion. However, if he stomps with his left leg, there will be a lingering electric AoE around him. And that one can remain until after his next attack. So when he does that, you need to stay away from him until that AoE has fully dissipated, or else simply going near him will already cause you to take damage. He can also do melee attacks with his arms, and that is actually something you want to bait him to do, because you can do massive damage to him if you parry that attack. And with a spear, if you repose by holding the square button, you will do a stab that hits multiple times for some reason, and you can do some really good damage with that. However, this is another example of a boss that takes massively reduced damage while the dialogue is playing. So it seems like you're only doing chip damage with your attacks, but that changes the moment the dialogue ends. So baiting parries is kind of useless until everyone's done talking. So when that happens, don't immediately move away from the boss unless he stomps with his left leg, which forces you to move away, because you're obviously not going to be able to parry him if you stay at a distance. Not that you have to, but come on, parrying is cool.
Kill him, feel the hate inside you.
Alright, when BP transforms and acquires his highly aerodynamic wings, that obviously are very suitable for flight, you only get the opportunity to do melee damage before he takes off, because then you will only be able to get magic attacks in. However, he will always start off by flying into the ceiling, which will cause debris to fall down. So here the slow motion effect of charging a magic attack comes in handy. However, the rapid fire of Dark Blast is obviously not helpful here, so instead I charge Dark Lance, so that I have a fully powered attack ready when the debris eventually stops falling. Pay close attention to the shadows, and remember that your rolling animation has a lot of iframes, and that's especially important when two pieces of debris fall down right next to each other. There doesn't seem to be an actual pattern to it, And it's also not the case that any location where debris already has come down is safe afterwards. It at least seems to be completely random, without any obvious safe zones. When the boss eventually comes down, he will start doing dive attacks. So again, the slow motion effect of charging magic is helpful when avoiding those as well. And although you can sometimes just avoid them by side strafing, that is actually not consistently reliable, so my advice is to side strafe and roll. I haven't tried this, but given the amount of iframes your rolling animation has, but then again, that doesn't seem to be an extra benefit to doing that to begin with. Now, other than those dive attacks, the boss can now at least use his arm cannons, although not machine gun fire like in the intro, but purple projectiles and only purple projectiles. So Dark Gluttony is useless here, and your Dark Blast bullets won't get through them either. However, the homing projectiles can arch around them, so that can allow you to still get some hits in on the boss. Side strafing is enough to avoid getting hit, and remember that rolling covers more distance than running. So if you feel that your positioning is off, then roll in order to move faster. By the way, don't let the sound throw you off, thinking that you actually got hit. Because that's not you getting hit, that's Emil getting knocked out. Even though he can fly as well, he does have a tendency to constantly get in the path of the boss's dive attack. Well, the poor guy keeps smiling though. When the boss is out of health, he will fly up into the ceiling one more time. So make sure to charge up Darklands again. Mainly for the slowing down effect this time, because the boss is already defeated. Well, at least the robot is, because once he lands, he will automatically break down. However, we still have to take care of Khalil in our blissful ignorance. Well, at least Nier's blissful ignorance. We are now fully aware of the tragedy of this fight. For some reason, multiple shades appear apart from Khalil. And remember that those small shades can do a single HP of damage whenever they are near you, so simply never underestimate them. Move away and quickly take them out before you focus on Khalil again, who doesn't seem to have any attacks, by the way. So you are then free to brutally murder an innocent child after destroying his only friend, and with the kind regards of our dear Shoko Taro, of course.
What on earth?
Okay, next up is Louise, who is our new boss that was specifically made for the remake. Well, the boss fight at least, the character itself apparently wasn't. So, given that it's a brand new boss fight, they had every opportunity to give her some really unique moves, but instead they gave her slam attacks that cause AoE shockwaves.
How original.
Yeah. Well, fortunately that's not the only thing she can do. She can also do a giant screaming AoE, or singing I should actually say. At least that's what she's attempting to do. And this covers a very large portion of the arena, but it has no tracking, so as long as you get out of the indicated area, you are safe and you don't necessarily have to hit her tentacles to do damage. You can hit her wherever until a gate appears. However, after her singing AoE, she will start firing projectiles from her tentacles, and it's a combination of red and purple projectiles. So, remember what I said before about Dark Gluttony. You can absorb the purple ones as well, as long as they are mixed together with the red ones. Pay close attention to your MP bar though, because unlike Dark Blast, if it is too low, you cannot use Dark Gluttony at all. So that could cause you to get hit.
Trying to eat us!
I actually jumped this time instead of rolling through the waves. It's not that the waves cannot be iframed, but these are a lot thicker than on the other bosses. So in this particular case, I prefer to jump instead. After you destroy one of the tentacles, several smaller tentacles will break through the floor, and after a short while, they will start firing projectiles at you. Only red ones, so you can use Dark Gluttony to fire back at them, and the homing projectiles of Dark Blast are effective as well. But these tentacles have quite a bit more health than you would expect, so I mainly go for one tentacle at a time, and I use melee attacks on the ones close to me, and then single shots from Dark Blast on the remaining ones, and Dark Gluttony when their projectiles come close to me. And again, remember to watch your MP bar when using Dark Blast and Dark Gluttony at the same time. After the small tentacles are gone, the fight continues like before, but with only the other large tentacle remaining, until you destroy it as well. However, it will now slam down twice in a row. By the way, when it shoots projectiles and you don't get the opportunity to use Dark Gluttony, because it's merely a wave of purple ones, make sure that you are blocking, or you could even stand in the far corner on the opposite side, because the projectiles will not reach that far. They will disappear before they can hit you for some reason.
Now is our chance. Attack with all that you have.
Did we get it? Oh hell, that thing's huge.
To emphasize again, this is Route C, and this boss fight is different on the C route. After breaking a tentacle, and be careful that she can now slam down both at once, so that's a double shockwave, so attack with the square button in mid-air to stay up in the air if necessary, so that you won't land on top of the wave. But after you break it, she will start charging up a giant magic attack, but this time you can stop her in time. And then you get to the third phase of the fight that wasn't there before in the previous route. I don't have footage of the previous version, but I can at least say that when she shoots arrows on the beach, you can avoid all of them by standing in the top right corner of this area, behind that piece of debris you see on the right side.
The guy from...
I think it's working!
It's concentrating tremendous magical energy into its head. Attacking it may... cause the power gathered there to...
Alright, so now you need to make your way to her core, but be careful that you don't fall off, because falling in the water will cause damage, and that's obviously not allowed in this playthrough. Now, you could cheese this final section with Darkwall, making you immune to all of her attacks, but that's against my own rules at least, so we are going for a different approach. First, we're going to take cover from her projectiles behind that bump in the middle, and then we're going to fire upwards with rapid fire from Dark Blast, and then release the homing projectiles that, with a little bit of luck, will break through the barrage and cause some damage at least. It won't be that much, but it's better than nothing. And when the barrage stops, Not only does that allow us to approach her, but the pattern will change with red projectiles aiming down towards us, meaning that we can absorb them with Dark Gluttony. Be careful though, as you need to stand just outside of the hitbox, because remember that you're still vulnerable for a short while, right after that first absorption. Then take cover again and repeat the process. When you can approach her again, you should be able to finish her off. Yeah, this is another sad story, and a very ironic one, given that Louise wanted to become human, even though she was a true human, and the people she ate were never truly human in the first place. Nor the postman, nor we ourselves for that matter. Alright, next up is the fight against Rock and his pack of wolves. And the beginning looks a bit weird, because I was experimenting with the Dark Execution spell, because I wanted to see how effective it was against the group of wolves. Well, turns out, not that effective. However, in retrospect, it is still a pretty handy spell to use because of how it changes the camera. Because the main issue in this fight is having to deal with multiple enemies in a small area. So you can use this spell in a similar way as I used the Mirage program in Automata, so for the change in camera distance. However, that is in retrospect, because I went back to using Dark Blast, but it may be a strategy that you want to check out. So your main concern in this fight is to not get stuck between wolves or between wolves and a wall, and secondly that you always need to be moving. Not only to avoid Rock's attacks, he can spin and shoot projectiles and he has a very fast dash attack, but just like the small shades, those other wolves can do a single HP of damage to you by simply bumping into you. And also, those wolves are quite tanky, so here's where the extra range of the spear comes in handy, as it allows you to sneak in some quick melee attacks. But never more than two light attacks, because remember that you need to keep moving. Now, just like shades, when a wolf is knocked down, you can execute it. And Kaine and Emil can in fact knock them down for you. Unfortunately, it's not that likely that you will get the chance to get close to them quick enough to do the execution move with the circle button. So you will likely have to take a more patient approach. When Rock remains by himself, you cannot merely rely on Dark Blast, because when he's running, he has a shield around him, and that will make your projectiles bounce off. So sneak in melee attacks right after he does one of his attacks. So right after you dodge his charge, or when he jumps up and rolls in the air to do the projectile attack, you can actually move towards him so that his projectiles go over you, and then you can sneak in some attacks as well. He recovers quickly though, so just like against the other wolves, only go for a few quick attacks. Or you can do a running attack, or even a running strong attack if you like. You know, the one where you do a somersault. As long as you move away from him afterwards, you will be fine. But keep his dash attack in mind though. And this is only the first phase of the fight though, or better said, it's essentially two separate fights. So now for the second fight, we have to deal with the rest of the pack, and that's a large amount of wolves to deal with. Fortunately, we have an army of our own this time. And if you wonder why I used Dark Ant at the start of the fight, well, that was some experimentation as well. And to be fair, it kinda works if the wolves are grouped together. But again, a lot of the sealed verses feel kind of underutilized. Or better said, you can use them, but there's often no need to use them. Or no really noticeable benefit to using them. Dark Blast is like the duct tape among the sealed verses. In almost any case, it's at the very least a sufficient solution. However, this time, because we are fighting as a large army, the wolves are mostly distracted and not specifically attacking you. So now I have the opportunity to watch out for wolves that get knocked down, so that I can quickly execute them with the circle button. And in the meantime, I can circle around the group while using Dark Blast. And because of the reach of the spear, I can still sneak in some melee attacks. And when they are clustered together, you can do an aerial attack with the triangle button to do a downward attack that could knock an entire group down at once. Won't always actually happen, but it is possible at least. It is kind of sad though to mercilessly slaughter all these wolves, especially now that you can see this war from both sides in the B and C route. But you know, at least it's not a single giant wolf with a sword in its mouth that starts limping before you are forced to kill it, because that would be even sadder.
The smaller wolves are not infected with shades, but as for the leader, if even one shade is here, then I have to kill all of them. Splendid. Now just keep pushing.
When the final wolf goes down, it's all of us against Rock, and he has basically the same moveset as before. However, he has now a jump attack that causes an AoE wave. Well, at least it's not technically a stomp or slam attack, so that's something at least. So every time he jumps on that little structure in the center, he will then jump down, causing an AoE wave. And he recovers very quickly, so don't try to roll through it to counterattack, because that can get you hit. But what's most likely to get you hit is his fast dash attack. So if you have trouble dodging it, then use rapid fire to slow down time, to give yourself some extra reaction time. Now one thing I didn't do, but should have done, is to quickly get close to him when his health bar is about to hit zero, because Dark Blast alone will not be enough to break the gauge before the timer runs out. You will need to combine it with melee attacks. So because I reacted too late, Rock had in fact the opportunity to heal himself. So keep that in mind.
セルガン、セダト、ヒュッド、アキ、ゲッタイシ。スラエ、フィア、ゾ、ゲンカ。
Well, I certainly didn't want to dislike this fight, because in principle it should be awesome, but mechanically it doesn't really work that well. First of all, if you would use Darkwall, you are practically invulnerable, and apart from when Devla starts using Dark End, neither of the twins will likely ever break your guard when blocking. So basically I intentionally use a suboptimal strategy in this fight to make it a bit more interesting. So I won't be blocking any of their attacks. Now, like several bosses before, while the dialogue is playing, you can hardly do any damage whatsoever, so in the beginning it's more about avoiding the twins until the dialogue stops. And in the first phase they only have short range magic orb attacks, which are easy to avoid to begin with, so the only real danger here is their teleportation. Because if they teleport to where you are standing, or if you get too close to them too soon after they teleport, they will knock you back and that will do a little bit of chip damage. So pay close attention to the floor and roll if they teleport underneath you or very close by. That's basically it for the first phase, but when the life bar is about 80%, that's where the real fight starts, where they gain the power of the sealed versus.
Thought you'd grow to be this powerful.
This is madness. Why do you block our path?
You have no cause to speak so with us, Grimoire Vice. You are a traitor.
Okay, so now they gain several attacks, including Dark Blast, which you can quite safely block without much chance of them breaking your guard, as I said. But given that I therefore wanted to do it without blocking, I counter it with Rapid Fire for my own Dark Blast to slow down time in order to maneuver myself in between their projectiles. Those projectiles don't move in a straight line though, and the final ones will in fact home in on you, just like your own ones do. So circle back around while sneaking some melee attacks in. After that they will shoot a single Dark Lance each, but I think their lock-on screwed them over because it didn't even go anywhere near me. Afterwards they will teleport and the process repeats itself a few times, until the twins split up and Devla starts using Dark End, while Popola keeps using Dark Blast attacks. So then you will need to divide your attention, and if you do it without blocking, the fight definitely will become a lot more interesting. Okay, so now Devla will start chasing you with Dark Hand attacks, and that will always be a two-hit combo. She doesn't move that quickly though, and thanks to the mini-map, you can focus on dodging in between Popola's projectiles while keeping an eye on Devla, even if she's off-screen. And whenever Popola is not firing at you, you can sneak in some attacks on her sister. So because she only does two-hit combos, you can do one or two melee attacks after that second punch, and then get out of her reach again. And just like in phase 1, you need to watch out for their teleports. In fact, I would argue that that's what's most likely to get you hit in this fight. It would have been really cool if they could use the other sealed versus as well, but this is it already. Well, at least we have a second encounter with them, and that one is a bit different. Unfortunately, that one is even less interesting. Which is definitely a shame, because I really liked the twins. And these fights are the ones that are leading up to the best boss fights in the game, namely the Shadow Lord, and the second encounter with the Shade version of Kaine.
Why?
The answer to every riddle lies within the heart of the Shadow Lord.
The Shadow Lord? So you've been on his side this whole time?
You must search for that answer yourself. You've got to face your own truth now. Please, enter the Shadow Lord's castle.
You okay?
Yeah. Well, we got problems.
Unfortunately, before we get to the really good fights, we first have to deal with the worst boss fight in the game, which is a giant boar, and also against a giant boar. But this entire fight is a giant boar, because it's pure tedium. The boss has two attacks, and it just goes on and on. And to add insult to injury, as I said at the start of the video, in this fight you will take script damage from a poison aura. I'm not aware of any way to avoid that damage. At this point in time, as far as I know, no one has been able to find a way to avoid it. If a method is ever found, I will add it into the description box at least. Now, one possible solution I could come up with that might work is if you play the game on easy, if you completely overlevel and use buffs so that you can essentially one-shot the boss and thereby keeping her knocked down so that she can never do a poison aura to begin with. But to be fair, I don't know if that's possible, and it may even be that if you one-shot her, she's still designed to do that attack regardless. I mean, in the second phase, it leads into a cutscene where Nier is overcome by that aura, so I wouldn't be surprised if that's the case. But at the very least, in these circumstances, I'm not aware of any way to avoid that poison damage. Even if you could cure it, which you can't, you would still take the initial damage. And also, not even Darkwall can protect you from it. Moreover, since it seems to be script damage, even if a workaround is discovered at some point, it would still have to be a developer oversight and not something that was intended. So other than the poison aura, the only thing the boss can do is charge at you, and if she hits a wall, she will knock herself down. And when she recovers and you are still close to her, she can do a belly flop that will cause an AoE shockwave. So technically that's not a stomp attack, I guess. And that's it, nothing else. I mean, she will gain armor after depleting her life bar once, which actually doesn't seem to make much of a difference. And on top of that, you cannot actually kill the boss in the first place. So it's all about staying alive until you can leave the room, where there will be a short chase sequence. Kind of a weird name for a boar, by the way, Goose. I mean, I know that most of the enemies are named after fairy tale characters, which already is kind of a strange theme. So I suppose that since this boss is a fusion of a mother and her children, that it's Goose as in Mother Goose. But it's still kind of far-fetched that they turn into a giant boar. And I mean, if it was intentionally far-fetched, they might as well have made it turn into a brown duck with a unibrow holding a leek stalk or something. I mean, that would have been far-fetched.
Oh dear.
So, here is the unavoidable poison aura. It doesn't matter how far you are away from the boss, it engulfs the entire room. I haven't tried this out, but I actually wonder what would happen if your health is close to zero, because given that it is scripted damage, I wouldn't be surprised if you actually cannot die from it in the first place. That it can drain your health, but not reduce it to zero. Of course, I don't know if that's the case, but it kinda makes sense at least. Then again, knowing Yoko Taro, if you've seen my Nier Automata walkthrough, where I got knocked off the bridge during 2B's breakdown section, where I literally had no more control over my character. Well, if you take that into account, then I'm actually not so sure anymore. Okay, so now we're going to get chased up the stairs, and if Goose catches you, you will automatically die. And the reason people tend to have problems with this section is because they slow down to pick up the items. But if you simply ignore all the items, and use Dark Blast to break the crates, blocking your way, and roll instead of run, since that makes you move faster, you can easily make it safely to the top of the stairs. And you will still acquire at least some of the items. So after that chase sequence, the second phase of the fight starts, and unfortunately, it's the exact same thing as before. The boss gains no new moves. So it's the same repeating process over and over until the cutscene starts, and you eventually are able to leave the room. So you might be wondering, because of the transition that indicates that I had to activate the checkpoint, meaning that I got hit, and had to redo this second section, how on earth could that have happened? Well, attention span. That's the issue here. If you get bored by this boring boar, you'll eventually get gored by this boring boar. By the way, it would definitely have been convenient if they had the option to load a checkpoint, given that the final save is before you enter this castle. So in the entire castle section, if you take a hit, you have to intentionally let yourself be killed to activate the checkpoint. Which can take a while, even on hard mode. Which is exactly why even on hard mode, the game is so easy when you are allowed to take damage. Because the bosses may be tanks, but so are you. I'm kind of glad that they took the opposite approach in Nier Automata, where it's you instead of the enemy's ability to take damage that is changed per difficulty setting. Which makes a lot more sense if you ask me. Although this game does have the benefit of more limited healing items, which is where Automata dropped the ball. So maybe there will be another Nier game in the future where they mix this together and get it right and balanced. Who can say?
But just realizing that isn't going to help. It's too late for us now. It's too late for everything. I'm too far gone, Yumi. That's why we...
Beast while it's down.
Hit the thing while it's down.
So here we have again the automatic damage from the poison aura, leading into a cutscene where the masked people will continue to fight for us. So at this point there's nothing left to do than avoid taking damage from the boss himself, because that's still avoidable, and then get out of the room as soon as the door is opened.
What
are you doing here?
You are correct.
But
stop! Let me go! Stop it! Damn it! King, no!
Gi, after that, Arikurasa. Ako.
No! Open the door! You can't fight that thing on your own!
You cook o Taoki, Aruta, Yuto!
Kuruto, Ko, Chi, Iru!
さて、ケタルイトエチケロアルテリアだせゲウジ各石岸新中カレルタカイザンテラスうんあんだ改めウラヌペルアトチウラヌカレルタトトチ
You have your own motives, your own desires. And we have ours. I fear it really is just that simple.
Don't speak such foolishness.
Sorry.
Alright, the second encounter with the twins. Although this time we more or less take on one at a time. Initially, Popola merely makes sure that her sister is covered in balls, while Devla tries to give us a handjob. And that's quite literally all there is to the first phase, unfortunately. In fact, you can completely cheese this fight by standing on the opposite side of the room, while firing Dark Blast at Devla, while Emil and Kaine distract her. Well, at least we can use the projectiles that surround her against her by using Dark Gluttony. And to emphasize once more, the purple ones can be absorbed as long as they are mixed together with the red ones. And of course, although Dark Blast cannot destroy the purple ones, melee attacks can. And by using the spear, you have a reach advantage. Be careful though whenever you are in between the twins, because when Popola shoots a new wave of projectiles towards her sister, that's already an active hitbox. Meaning that if you're not careful, you can get hit by those projectiles before they even reach Devila. And just like in the first encounter, watch out for when Devila teleports. Immediately roll if she spawns right underneath you. And don't get near her until that aura around her has fully dissipated, because otherwise you will take chip damage. And one last thing that can catch you off guard is that on rare occasions, Devila will shoot a single Dark Lance projectile. So that's why you should not stay in place, but side strafe as much as possible when you are at a distance.
Now you want to stop?
Popola, wait! It doesn't have to...
No one stops! It's way too late to stop! No one stops!
After Devila dies and Popola goes berserk, we have another example of a fight where Darkwall would be completely overpowered, since it would make you completely immune to her attacks. But to be fair, in a way I would kind of advise to use it anyway, because without it, this phase will take forever, since you cannot safely use melee attacks without it. And Dark Gluttony does very little damage to her, and she does nothing other than going full Toho on you. So it's simply a matter of redirecting her projectiles towards her with Dark Gluttony, while keeping your guard up for the bullets that slip through. And then you can slowly whittle down her health bar. Like quite a few boss fights in this game, I do feel like there's quite a bit of wasted potential. The moveset of especially the twins could have easily been extended. I mean, they have the power of the Sealed Versus, so why not have them use every single one? I think that's quite a shame. Well, at least after this, and after a short fight with Grimoire Noir, We will be facing off against the Shadow Lord and then Kainé's Shade, where the mechanics of this game will in fact get the chance to shine, since those fights are mechanically vastly superior to the rest of the bosses. So the potential was definitely there, it's simply a matter of execution.
Ever.
So before we can take on the Shadow Lord, we first have our second and final encounter with Grimoire Noir, and it's more or less a combination of the two phases of the previous fight. This time he can turn into his orb form from the start, and he will spawn pages behind him while rolling through the room, which is significantly bigger than the library was. Which might seem like a bigger deal than it actually is, because of one very peculiar property. And that is that he now very easily staggers out of his orb form for some reason. So after the first time he spawns Pages, you can essentially keep him stunlocked for the entire remainder of the fight, by attacking after the orb breaks, move back when he summons it again, and then shoot at it with Dark Blast, and it will just break after a few shots for some reason. Now the reason that you still have to move back is that he can still hit you if you start spinning right before the orb breaks. But in the end, this is all you need to do. I'm not sure why it works this way this time around, but there you go.
Don't relax yet. It's not over.
Alright, and there we are, the original Nier, also known as the Shadow Lord. In all honesty, fighting this boss suboptimally is actually a lot cooler, but it takes ages, so I don't recommend that. But I will show some additional footage from an attempt where I essentially went for only melee attacks. So also no slow motion. Looks and plays really awesome, but not exactly the most effective approach, of course. So first let me show you what is a more effective method. Unless you would count cheesing with Darkwall, but that's a waste of a good boss fight. Although, unfortunately, even though this is one of the best boss fights in the game, it also has a major downside. And that is that for 1 minute and 20 seconds, the boss takes virtually no damage because of the dialogue. So that will become really freaking tedious really freaking quick. So for 80 seconds, you might as well run around the room until the dialogue ends, because before that, you cannot do any real significant damage to the boss anyway. So as you can see, I charged up Dark Lance in a similar way to our first encounter with Kaine. Not just for the extra damage, but mainly to use the slow motion effect to help me parry the boss. And then when he's on the ground, you can release the Dark Lances. Or better said, if he's on the ground, because a riposte doesn't necessarily have that effect. In fact, it might not even stun him. Meaning that you need to immediately dodge away from him after riposting if he poises right through it. Because the riposte animation itself has iframes, so therefore you need to roll away to make sure that you don't get hit right after the riposte animation. And then I switch to Dark Blast, because that simply does way more damage in the long run than Dark Lance. But of course, as I mentioned in the very first boss fight in this video, it does make it harder to see the boss's attacks coming, which can screw up your parry timings. However, in this fight, there is a way to tell when you can get a relatively easy parry. Either when the boss comes running towards you, so don't run up to him for a parry, but let him come to you, unless it's only to close the distance when he's already running towards you. But another way is right after he does the vertical Dark Lance barrage. He shoots Dark Lances vertically a single time, or horizontally up to 3 times in a row, which he will do if you are circling around him after the vertical barrage. But if there's distance between you and him, then he will run up to you for a melee attack after that vertical barrage. So that's how you know that a parry opportunity is coming. And the same applies when he gains the teleportation move. First of all, roll away when he's underneath you, because that is a hitbox. Then circle around to avoid the projectiles. And then keep circling and roll if necessary to avoid his downward sword attack. You can then get a quick counterattack in, and then you will very likely follow up with the vertical Dark Lances. And you will get another parry opportunity. There are 2 other moves he can do. If he suddenly stands still and takes no damage at all, that means that he's blocking. So basically the same thing that you can do. Well, he is you, in a way. And other than Dark Lance, he also has the Dark Execution move, where he summons spears from the ground. And don't underestimate that move, it covers a large section of the room, and the spears do track you a bit. They don't go in a straight line, so side strafe or circle around that move, either until you pass the spears, or until they stop spawning. And remember that both for parrying, as well as for avoiding his teleportation move, it can help to use Dark Blast's rapid fire instead of single shots for the slow motion effect. And remember to hold the square button when riposting for extra damage. Before we continue with the second phase, here is some extra footage from, unfortunately, a failed attempt. Very unfortunate, in fact, because it was a pretty epic fight, but also very drawn out, where I essentially went for a sort of melee-only strategy, or melee-focused, I should say. And especially because of the lack of slow motion, it makes it a really intense battle. And here I approach the Dark Lance attacks differently, because if you circle around him, which you can best do clockwise, because he shoots the horizontal Dark Lances from his left to his right, and as I said, up to 3 times in a row, although you can stagger him out of that with your own attacks, and you can also iframe the lances. Although that does require some precision, because it's a large hitbox, and it moves very quickly. But to be fair, I don't actually recommend this approach at all, but I did want to include some extra footage, because it simply looks really cool and really intense. And it also gives you a taste of what the next fight is going to be, given that we are then forced to use melee attacks only. Thank you. Okay, the second phase. Unless you want to cheese this phase, which you actually can do by standing right underneath the boss, but that's kind of boring. So instead, create some distance, because now he will shoot projectiles onto the floor that turn into fiery pillars. And you can actually roll through these Dark Souls style. Although, unlike in a Souls game, you have iframes for your entire roll. So for me, it kind of felt like I was rolling too early, but that's simply not the case in this game.
Now come on! Let's finish this!
When the dialogue ends, he will charge straight towards you, and on the ground, he will go back to his previous moveset. But after a single teleportation, you can expect him to take flight again. So create distance and be ready to dodge through more magical pillars. And if he just hangs there without shooting, that means that he might actually charge towards you again instead of shooting more projectiles. So be ready for that if he does. And just like in the previous phase, if he does the vertical dark lances, that means another parry opportunity. Near the end of this phase, he will really go berserk with his magical pillars, and they will start speeding up, meaning that there is less and less room between the waves. So that will really test your reaction time. You do have a lot of iframes, but that of course won't help you if you roll too late. Okay, final phase, and we've lost Grimoire Wise, so no spells and no slow motion. This is more about precision and reflexes than strategy, but what I can at least say is to move along the sides, and once you get behind the last wave, do a dash attack with the square button, because it's not the case that you are safe when you are behind him. And you will have to do that 3 times, since each time you hit the boss, you will get knocked back across the room. Fortunately, that does no damage, even though we cannot bring up the status screen without Wise. But if your life bar doesn't flash, then you haven't taken any damage. And speaking of Wise, thanks to his sacrifice, we can finally take down the Shadow Lord. Although, after all of that, Wise still didn't get a big sloppy kiss from the Shadow Lord. So that's kind of insulting. Alright then, now it's time for the best fight in the game, in my opinion. And when going for no damage, this is a very challenging fight. It kinda makes me wonder why not the majority of the boss fights could have had the quality of Kainé and the Shadow Lord. But before the actual fight starts, you first get a phase in which you cannot do any damage yet, and you'll have to guard yourself against a massive bullet hell. So here especially, it's important to not overestimate your ability to block projectiles, because although I managed to do this successfully the first try, I just realized that if you would get guard broken here, due to the lack of an option to reload the last checkpoint, you would have to go through the entire freaking castle again to retry this section. Unless you manage to get killed before this phase ends. But once it ends, you cannot go back. So definitely only block as few projectiles as possible. And remember that due to the absence of Wise, there's also no option to use words that boost your guard resistance. And to be clear, I haven't used those in this playthrough to begin with. I went for damage boost and experience boost instead. But I could imagine why you would have wanted it, given how far back the last save point is. But after this bullet hell, the real fight starts. And here I will have to break down Kainé's moveset a bit better, in order to explain what exactly is happening in this fight. Because this is a pretty complex fight with quite a few things that you need to take into consideration.
We made it this far because you were with us, Kaine. I'm who I am today because of you. I'm not going to give up on you. I'm not going to abandon someone I love. I'm going to save you. I swear it!
First of all, Kaine has two different movesets based on what position she's in. One when she's in a crawling position, so let's call this her shade moveset. And one when she's standing up straight, so let's call that her human moveset, as it's a modified version of the first encounter against her before Hook. And the shade moveset is a sort of modified version of the second encounter after Gretel. Let's start with what's arguably her most dangerous attack, that is shared by both of her movesets, and that's what I would call her flash attack. It's extremely fast, and its projectile has no range limit. And she can do this attack basically at any time. And although it is possible to parry it, the timing required is extremely precise. So I don't recommend doing that. Now you could actually use this move to your advantage by moving and dodging around her, and counterattacking in between her attacks. And sometimes her attack will even miss you without the need to dodge at all, if you circle around with her and you're close enough. However, this is very difficult to keep going consistently, because at any time she can first move before she does it, so then your positioning can be off. Or she can delay it, and then timing becomes an issue. Moreover, the moment she stands up, she will go into her human moveset, meaning that she can immediately cancel into kicks or regular sword slashes, including one with projectiles. The next attack is a double dash attack. Now, because it's a double attack, it's easy to take a hit here by trying to dodge both, as she will likely not be able to dodge fast enough twice in a row. In fact, depending on her position, this can even be impossible to do. So when dodging it, it's far more effective to stay out of the reach of the first dash and then dodge only through the second, or vice versa when you're close to her. However, I prefer to use this attack to my advantage because you can parry it. So that's what I mainly try to do. Then there's her bullet hell attack, which she starts the fight off after a flash attack. And this one is a bit tricky to respond to because of the weird rules governing when a boss staggers from your attack. The first time she does it, holding the square button will stagger her out of this attack, but the second time she does it, she will very likely not stagger, so then doing the same thing could get you hit, although this is not completely consistent. I tend to use it as a rule of thumb that what staggered her before will not stagger her the next time, but will stagger her again the third time. But to be clear, this is only a rule of thumb, not an actual guarantee. Her human moveset is similar to her first encounter, so you can parry her sword slashes and her kicks, although I almost tend to mistime the kicks and end up blocking. However, she has two new, very dangerous attacks. One that is a sword slash that's followed by a wave of projectiles, and unless you manage to parry that very attack, where your iframes save you from getting hit by the projectiles, but if it's not a successful parry, it's easy to get hit by those projectiles. And on top of being able to use a flash attack at any time, she can also do a dash attack at any time. Just like in her first encounter, I'm not aware that this attack can be parried, but it still cannot be blocked. All in all, in my opinion, her human moveset is harder to deal with than her shade moveset, which is why I tend to be far less aggressive when she's standing up, because I want to bait her into crawling down again. However, once she grunts in agony near the end of the fight, she will not return to her shade moveset again, so you need to keep that in mind. And to emphasize again, other than the strange rules of how guard breaks work, the same applies to what staggers or knockdowns the boss. First of all, at certain points, Kaine will be completely vulnerable while she is in this sort of prayer position. So that is free damage, and parries or jumping strong attacks can knock her down on the ground. However, you cannot predict if this will actually happen, as she can poise right through these attacks. So pay close attention to whether she's knocked on the ground, merely staggered out of her animation, or whether her attack animation continues unbroken. Also, the further you get into the fight, the faster she recovers from a knockdown, meaning that she can instantly cancel into an attack, even a flash attack, the moment she recovers, so definitely don't get greedy with your attacks when she's on the ground, especially not when she's low on health. Okay, so let's check out the successful attempt. I will slow certain sections down so you can better see exactly what is going on. Okay, start by side-strafing the flash attack, dodge through the first projectile wave, and get behind her and knock her down by holding the square button. Then wait to see what she does, either the flash attack or the double dash attack. And if she pauses, she will likely do the double dash. So be ready to parry it. And hold square again if it knocks her down. When she stands up, create distance, but always make sure to side strafe in case she does the running dash attack or the flash attack. And let her come to you if you want to parry her. When she does the bullet hell attack again, remember that this time you will likely not be able to knock her down, so be ready to block the third and fourth wave. However, you can then expect her to get into that prayer position, where you can get a lot of free hits in. Then move back to see what she does again. Double dash in this case, so parry, and no knockdown this time. Then back to her human moveset, so create distance again and preemptively side strafe in case she does the flash or running dash. And not only did I end up mistiming the kicks, but also the double dash when she went back into shade mode. Then the third time doing her bullet hell attack, you can expect that you will knock her down again like the first time. Again, weird mechanic, but it is what it is. Then back to her human moveset again. Fortunately, she did a few sword slashes, which are much easier to parry than her kicks. However, as I said, I tend to play more passively in this mode, because I wanted to go back into her shade moveset. However, she didn't actually end up doing that. And once her health bar gets around 15%, she will never go back to her shade form, at least as far as I was able to tell. So I got a bit nervous here, because I was screwing up the parries on her kicks. And remember that you cannot just keep blocking, because then she will eventually guard break you. So it's helpful to block the first attack of a combo, and then to parry the second one. But only do that if you haven't already blocked several attacks in a row. Otherwise, it might turn into a guard break. Another thing you can do is the downward thrust, so a jumping triangle attack, which can knock her down, but not repeatedly, just like with parries or the bullet hell attack. So that is a risky move, because you don't have iframes at any point in that animation. So I only risked doing it again when no knockdown was required anymore, namely when she was only one attack away from death. Very difficult fight to do without taking damage, especially without using any buffs, but definitely the best boss fight in the game. Which kind of shows how much better a lot of the other fights could have been, given the possibilities of the mechanics of this game. Which in all honesty is a little bit disappointing. But now of course we get to play as Kaine herself, which is really awesome, because I love her moveset. So even though it's only a short section, I am very happy that they made this extra content. Especially because it's a more satisfying ending in my opinion. What I'm a little less happy about is that they gave this brand new boss a stomp attack that causes AoE waves.
How original.
Yeah. Well, it's the electric version just like P33, but still. However, this boss also frequently does a charge attack that can actually be parried. Unfortunately, this boss also takes reduced damage at the start when the dialogue is playing. You can also parry his regular attacks he does with his arms. However, he will actually miss you when you are in between his legs, which is both positive and negative, because you can use that to your advantage to safely do regular sword slashes. But negative if you want to go for a parry, because you need to purposely move back to put yourself into that hitbox. Now, contrary to P33's stomp attacks, not only don't they linger in the same way, but Kaine has an incredible effective dodge that seems to even have more iframes than Nier's has. In fact, I will show some extra footage from a failed attempt when I was testing this out. So I simply iframe the stomp attacks. And it's most effective to not dodge into any direction, just press the evade button to dodge away from him, and then your attacks will automatically move you towards him. Otherwise, you can actually miss your attacks when you dodge through him. And whenever he does his charge attack from close by, I dodge through it rather than parry it. Because your reaction window is then much smaller, since he moves very fast and is already close to you. So only go for parries when he charges at you from a distance. And repose by holding the square button, because the animation of the triangle button largely misses the boss. That one seems to be better suited for regular shades.
Let's see us.
So here's some footage from a failed attempt demonstrating how overpowered Kaine's dodge can be. To be fair, this feels oddly satisfying when I've done Dark Souls 2 with only 6 ADP for the people watching who are familiar with that series.
This is the deepest place in your memories.
Memories you had sealed away.
And this one is your worst memory.
Okay, final boss. Although it's more of a set piece than a full-on boss fight. But as a set piece, it is very impactful at least. The first phase is quite short, and by now you should know what to expect from Hook, although there are some slight differences. First of all, in the first phase, we don't have Grimoire Wise yet, and therefore no magic attacks. So that also means that we cannot slow down time. So keep that in mind while dodging the AoEs from his hands. But first he will charge towards you, so immediately get out of the way, and then you can get the initial damage in to make the gauges on his hands appear. So that can be done wherever, but after that his hands are obviously our targets. His hand slams are the quick variation, so don't get greedy with your attacks. It's best to go for single strong attacks only, especially because of the lack of slow motion. He will cycle between doing hand slams, then teleporting away to do the charge attack, then teleporting away again to do more hand slam attacks. This will repeat until you break both gauges, and then the first phase of the fight, at least as far as attacking is concerned, is already over. It's now only a matter of preventing taking damage until the inevitable damage that you take from his charge up magic attack. And even though you can destroy the ball shades he spits out, that actually makes no difference to the amount of human figures that then appear when he engulfs the arena. After which, those figures will unleash a bullet hell upon you. So get into a corner of the arena, and face directly forward, so with your back towards the corner, and keep your guard up. As long as you're facing directly forward, you should be able to safely block every projectile that reaches you.
To you. Uh-oh. I think it's charging up its magic.
So here we have the damage that you cannot prevent. In fact, you are meant to lose this phase, which leads into a cutscene. And on top of that, after the cutscene, your life bar is completely refilled anyway. And to emphasize again, neither blocking, jumping, rolling or dark wall will prevent you from taking this damage. And the whole point, of course, is that you cannot break the gates to prevent him from doing that attack without the help of Grimoire Wise. And that is exactly who will come to our aid in the second phase. Alright, so now we have our favorite floating book back. Meaning we can use magic again, which unfortunately did not match my custom control settings, so that kind of threw me off. But now we can not only prevent Hook from doing his giant charging magic attack, but we can also use slow motion again when avoiding his AoEs. So the fight is very straightforward now, however he still has some tricks up his sleeves.
Use my power to knock the creature down with magic. Now clobber the beast!
Let's fuck it up good! Shit, this thing is tough.
Let the next onslaught.
Okay, once he reaches half health, he will summon a bullet hell scenario. So quickly move towards a bottom corner of the arena again and hold your sword up. Keep in mind that you can guard against projectiles up to a 90 degree angle or so. So adjust your position accordingly. And also keep in mind that you can now destroy bullets with Dark Blast. This is not the only bullet hell scenario though, because just like in the first phase, he can spit out ball shades again, and then there will be a similar bullet hell scenario. And you cannot actually prevent him from doing that, but what you can do is deplete his entire life bar while he is spitting out those shades, because it takes a long time before the bullet hell phase will actually start. And again, you cannot prevent it, but at least then you will know that the fight will be over once you come out of that phase.
Damn it, Book. He's doing this.
I see.
So for this bullet hell phase, you also need to get in the corner again. However, you will automatically lose your balance when he briefs across the platform. So you will have to quickly reposition yourself. And I almost screwed up here, because if the angle is off, so if you're facing too much up, then the bottom bullets can still hit you. Fortunately, I was able to reposition myself. Also, now you can destroy the figure shooting those projectiles using your own homing projectiles. And although they will respawn, it will at least decrease the number of projectiles that you need to block. And be careful that when the camera angle changes at the end of this phase, those projectiles don't immediately stop, meaning that you could potentially get hit at the very end if you immediately drop your guard.
Let us finish this.
Well, just like Wise said, let's finish this playthrough. Thank you all for watching and leave a like and comment if you enjoyed the video. And check the description box and the pinned comment for a link to my Nier Automata Very Hard difficulty guide, which feels a little bit outdated since it was one of my earliest series on the channel. But I might actually do a Very Hard melee-only playthrough soon. So if you want to see more of me, consider subscribing to the channel. And if you want early access, then consider supporting me on Patreon. In the end, this game was a little bit of a mixed bag for me, but it had a very impactful story, amazing soundtrack, and doing this no damage playthrough really allowed me to get far more out of the boss fights and the mechanics in general. So I hope that it inspires you to do the same and help you along with it. Or at least that it was educational and entertaining. Thanks again and see you next time.
Go back.
Shut up! I already made up my mind. Nobody tells me what to do. I swore I would be a sword. I swore that I would be your sword. Do you hear me? So I am going to get you back, and I don't care what it takes. Who the fuck do you think you are to just up and disappear like that, huh? I'm the one who gets to decide what my life means to me. It's my life, and I'll do whatever I want with it. So quit wasting time like a brainless fuckwit and get your ass back here now!